Greetings, cyberdogs and citizens of the internet. This is Rendog coming at you from Griswold's apartment in this Let's Play Minecraft Survival series. In the previous episode, we were working on the entrance to the Cyberdog Monument, and in this episode, my friends, we are going to be applying a Cyberdog design to that monument to finish it off. And let me tell you something, my friends, it is going to be freaking sweet! So I hope you have your tasty-ass beverage and a crunchy-ass snack. Let's play some Minecraft freaking survival. Now guys, before we get going on today's episode, I would like to draw your eyeballs towards this epic jumper that I have on and these really pimping-ass leather boots that I'm wearing. And these were a gift from a cyberdog sent to me on dogcraft.net. Just got them in the post a couple days ago. It's a freaking Christmas present from a cyberdog called Mastermind. Thank you so much, Mastermind, for this epic Christmas present. I'ma be wearing it. I'ma be wearing my Christmas sweater all the way from now until Christmas. And it's about 4 days to go to Christmas, 3 days to go to Christmas. And if you're from somewhere in the future, Christmas has come and gone, and I hope you got something sweet. But anyway, guys, let's get on with today's freaking episode. You guys may have noticed also that things are looking a little bit cheery around this place, man. Griswold has been placing some sweet ass Christmas candles around here. He's put up his own Christmas tree in his little apartment over here. It's a little bit cramped in here now that Greg 2 is also in here, man. Check it out. Greg 2's all agitated, man. He doesn't have anywhere to move. But at least he's doing a good job of protecting the freaking Christmas tree and protecting Griswold, that freaking butthole. But there have been some very cheerful things going on around Rentopia and around Mole City. Maybe we should just take a quick look, shall we? You can see that Bark is on almost half durability. Bark and I have been busy, man. Both Beatrice and Griswold came to me when I was chilling in my bedroom, and they were like, "Mr. Rendog, we need Christmas trees. Do you mind going to the forest grove and cutting down some fir trees for us?" And I was like, "Beatrice, I'll do anything for you, girl. Anything at all." So I went over to the forest grove, and I managed to cut down a few fir trees. And you can see that old Beatrice has also been messing around with her little quarters over here. She's got some sweet ass Christmas lights around here. She's also got a nice little Christmas tree in here. And I think that for Christmas itself, I think that we're all going to come and gather inside of Beatrice's quarters over here and tell a few stories, read a few Cyberdog emails. We'll all be in there, man. Beatrice, Griswold, the dogs, the cats, man. It's going to be cramped up in there, but Beatrice has already started cooking the turkey. She's going to be cooking this turkey for 4 days, man. It's going to be a huge-ass turkey, let me tell you something. But, man, I can smell it all over Mole City. It's going to be tasty. Man, even Big Mac wants to come along for the Christmas special. So maybe Big Mac will come with us, too. Anyway, guys, something else has also popped up in Mole City that maybe you guys want to take a look at, man. Before I show you guys, last year for Christmas, all we actually did was stick a tiny little Christmas tree in my bedroom and read a few dog mails. And you know what? I thought this year for Christmas 2013, let's do something freaking festive up in this jazz, man. Let's get in the festive mood, man. Let's get in the Christmas mood. And if you guys have been on dogcraft.net recently, you'll see that all of the other guys in the Cyberdog Network, Bego and Mud Dog, Razor, Strife, and Ivan Dogovich, and everyone on dogcraft.net, everybody's getting in the Christmas mood right now, man. Dogcraft is a place of Christmas cheer and Christmas spirit right now. And right over here, guys, we have the Cyberdog Christmas tree, and it is looking freaking sweet. And as you can see, man, there are presents down here for 80,000 Cyberdogs. And man, it's gonna take a long ass time for you guys to open all your presents, but they are here underneath this tree. And as you can see, I've used a little bit of stained glass to make some cool Christmas baubles on our tree. And man, it is looking awesome. So you know what? Mole City is all Christmassy this year, man. It is awesome. I'm loving this jazz, man. I'm just getting into it this year, man. I'm getting into the Xmas vibe this year. But guys, let's head over to the Cyberdog Monument. We have quite a lot of freaking work to do today. So what I'm going to be doing is telling you guys a sweet story about my very first band. Well, actually my second band that I was in. And I want to tell you guys a story about my mama dog. I think that for the next few episodes of this survival series, I want to be talking a little bit about my family. You know, it's Christmas time. It's family time. I'm not going to be in South Africa with my family this year. So, you know, I think I want to tell you guys a few stories about my amazing family. And it'll just help me, like, think about them and remind me of them during this festive season and this family season over here. So, guys, while I'm working walking on the Cyberdog Monument today, I'm going to tell you a story about when Mama Dog took me and my band to a festival. Let's just say it didn't really go too well for us, but I'm going to tell you that story in a moment, guys. Here we are in the Cyberdog Monument. As you can see, I've laid down some freaking quartzage all over this show. I've raised a few pillars up in here also, trying to sort of get a better idea of how the walls are going to look. And basically what I've decided to do is, because we don't have a lot of wall space to work with, literally all we have is these two blocks over here and these two blocks over here that connect the balconies together, we can't really do much with the walls, right? So what I thought I would do is, because we have this sort of awkward bend over here because of the octagon, I made the straight part of the wall glass, and then I want to make the diagonal part of the wall actually an open space. And I think that it works quite well. I think that it opens up the monument quite nicely. We're only going to be able to see if it actually looks really freaking sweet once all the walls are up and all the balconies are installed. But I kind of like this design, and this is where I'm at right now with the walls. I think it's going to be pretty awesome. But what I've also realized, guys, and this is based largely on the feedback from you guys, is that these balconies are pretty damn boring, man. You know, these balconies are like, they're cool. I mean, this balcony's okay, but you know, currently our mission in survival is to go big or go freaking home, man. Like, we want to make stuff that's really awesome, that's really freaking huge, and that's really pimping. And what I thought we would do is, for the horizontal balconies, so for these balconies over here, the horizontal ones going that way and the horizontal ones going this way, why don't we try and pimp out these balconies more? Let's turn them into like really epic building structures, and then the diagonal balconies, so these ones, can just be like this design, just because it's really, really difficult to build in a diagonal. And this is going to help with like all of the OCD issues around the symmetry and everything also. As long as we make sure all the diagonal balconies are perfectly symmetrical and all of the horizontal balconies are perfectly symmetrical, we are freaking A for away, man. So that's what we're going to be doing today, guys. And I was on Dogcraft the other day. I was in chat just chilling with some cyber diggity dogs, and a cyber dog came in and sent me a screenshot of a really epic design of the walls for the Cyberdog Monument. This Cyberdog was like, hey, I've got this awesome design for the walls of the monument, check it out, sent me the screenshot. And I was like, man, that design is so freaking awesome. Unfortunately, it's a design that is only viable or only possible on like straight walls. And you guys might already see something over here that I'm pointing at over here. This right here, guys, is the design that the Cyberdog sent me. And it's literally quartz pillars going into a bit of chiseled quartz and then rinse and repeat that. So what I've done is I've added it to the sides of the entrance to give you a bit of an idea of what it looks like. And I think that that looks absolutely freaking sweet. I absolutely love this design. Everybody in the chat was like, yeah, man, that design is so awesome. Rendog, you got to use it. You got to use it. So I'm gonna be using this Cyberdog design to build the balconies of the horizontal or the walls of the horizontal balcony. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to turn these balconies into like proper rooms of the Cyberdog Monument. They're gonna follow this design over here. The walls of these balconies over here are gonna follow this design, and we'll probably put like glass panes or glass in there, or stained glass or something like that. We'll give it a go, man. We'll do some experimenting and whatnot. But it is going to be freaking sweet, my people. So what I'm going to do now is just get busy building the very first balcony over here with this new wall design over here. And hopefully it's going to be as epic as I think it's going to be. I've got a feeling, though, that it is going to be freaking sweet, man. So let's just make a few pillars out of our last remaining quartzage. And man, I am running out of quartz already. Let me tell you guys, I've been to the Nether a lot. And I've been grinding like nobody's freaking business, man. It has been an intense grinding session going on in the Nether. But I'm pretty close to all the quartz that we need, I think. The roof of the Cyberdog Monument is probably going to be made out of glass, like a dome shape out of glass. So I don't know how much quartz we're still going to need. The one thing we are desperately missing, though, is freaking lapis. We're definitely going to have to go on a huge lapis grind at some point again. But Let's focus on today's episode, guys, and that's going to be making this sweet-ass freaking balcony area over here. It is going to be awesome, man. Sit back and relax, guys. Let's do some freaking crafting. Now, today I want to talk a little bit about my mama dog and one of my favorite memories of my mama dog. And this memory that I have of my mom is actually like a really important memory to me, because it's one of the very first things that my mom did for me that at the time I didn't realize like how awesome it was when she did it for me, but like she basically, you know, basically she helped me like try and follow a dream, right? And she recognized that I had this dream, and she was like, okay, I'm gonna do everything that I can for my son to try and make his dream a reality. And she really did do everything that she could for me to try and make this dream a reality. Even though in the end it didn't quite pan out the way that I hoped it would. but this dream was a dream that I had from when I was, I don't know, probably about 10 years old. Now, I come from a family of musicians. My mum is a musician. My first dad was a musician. And for those of you guys who are maybe new CyberDogs, my dad passed away when I was 6 years old. And my mum remarried a few years later. So, like, I have a stepdad, but I consider my stepdad my dad, because I didn't really know my real dad. I was, you know, I was only like 6 years old when he passed, so I have very, very few memories of my real dad. But they were both musicians in the South African Orchestra, and we grew up in a musician family. So from a very, very young age, my brother and I, the Goxie, we were learning musical instruments. So to begin with, we started learning to play the piano when we were really young. I still remember my very first piano lesson with my mum. I was probably like 4 years old or something. I mean, I was super young, man. I was a lighty, as we say in South Africa. And after that, after I got a little bit older, I started playing other instruments also. So my mum started to teach me how to play the cello, which is like a really big ass violin, basically, is the only way to describe what a cello is. And I played the cello for quite a bit. I mean, I think for probably 2 years or so. And I still remember that at one point in my life when I was a kid, my mum and I would wake up at like 5 in the morning, and we would practice cello for 30 minutes, and then we would practice piano for 30 minutes, and then we would go have breakfast, and then we would go to school, and then when I got back in the evening, I would practice more piano. And we did that for like a couple of years, man. It was serious, man. You know, like, my mum really wanted us to become musicians, I guess, and really wanted us to become masters of our instruments. But for some reason, like, my brother and I, even though we did love music and we did love piano and we played a lot, man. Like, I've always been I put in inverted commas a musician. I mean, I'm not really like a professional musician, but I do, you know, I do love music. I do play guitar, as some of you guys know. And I love music, man. Like, I probably play guitar like at least an hour or 2 hours a day. And when I was living at home with my mum and my dad and my family, my brother and I used to be at the piano all the time, man. We used to be playing piano, we used to be playing guitar, we used to be playing any instrument that we could, really. And we started making music on computers, and like when we were really, really young, like we were always just like making music, being a part of music. But when I turned probably like 10 or so, and suddenly girls became a thing, you know? You know, like, there's a moment in a boy's life, right, where all you really care about before this moment is like computer games and playing outside and, you know, finding forts and I don't know, like everything that boys like, right? But there's a moment when suddenly girls are like really interesting, and they're no longer disgusting, or they're no longer foul, or you know, you don't want to have anything to do with them. Suddenly girls are like really awesome, and suddenly girls are like really, really hot. And you know, you want to do everything you can to impress these girls. Let's have a look what this is looking like. Oh man, that is looking sweet. That is looking so much better than like just that normal balcony that we had. That is looking awesome, man. We need to figure out how we're going to do the roof though. But anyway, guys, this moment came, and I was like, I don't know, I was probably like 10 or 11, right? And we started hanging out with girls. We started like having socials, is what we called them, where we would go and we would go to somebody's house for the evening, and then it would be a whole bunch of girls and a whole bunch of guys, and we would spend like the evening there. We'd play like spin the bottle and stuff like that. Although I don't think our parents knew that we were playing those kind of games, but it was all pretty innocent stuff, really. And at this time, I was still playing the cello and the piano. And I thought to myself, you know what? The cello and the piano, like, while I do love them and while they are pretty sweet, I don't think that they're like the sexiest of instruments. I mean, I wish, you know, I wish that I had never thought that now, because like when you're older, if you can play the cello, damn, girls are gonna like that, man. Cello is some sexy jazz. But when you're like 10, you know, the cello is just like such a nerdy instrument to be playing. And, you know, I was like, man, I don't want to be playing the cello, man. I want to be playing an instrument that like girls are gonna think is really, really like awesome. And so I said to my mom, I want to start playing the guitar. Because my stepdad is like a big rock fan, you know, like some of his favorite bands are like Led Zeppelin, Def Leppard, Metallica. And when my brother and I were growing up with my stepdad, this is the music we were listening to. We were listening to my dad, or my stepdad's music. And he, like, he was big into like blues. He was big into like 70s rock, stuff like that, right? Jimi Hendrix and all that sort of stuff, man. And I thought to myself, well, what could be sexier than freaking Jimi Hendrix? I mean, you know, I want to play the freaking guitar, man. Like, the guitar is such an awesome instrument. And I'm pretty sure I'll be able to get a girlfriend. I mean, I was the guy at socials, and I'm sure some of you guys will be able to relate to this. But I was the guy at socials who didn't speak to any girls at all, man. I was like so nervous all the time. I honestly couldn't. The thought of even just like speaking to a girl was basically impossible to me. And I used to go to socials and just like hang out in the corner and like not speak to anybody, or just speak to like a few of my other nerd friends, and we just talk about computer games and stuff. And I thought to myself, you know what, if I can start playing the guitar, maybe this will change my fortunes, man. Maybe, just maybe, girls will start to think that I'm really freaking sweet. And you know, maybe I'll get a girlfriend, or maybe I'll even get a kiss, man. That was the primary goal, right? Was just a kiss. So I said to my mom, you know, I want to start playing the guitar. So my mum's had a really good friend at her school. She was a teacher, and she had like a good friend who was a guitar teacher there. And she started setting up lessons for me with this guitar teacher. And he was an inspirational teacher. He was amazing, man. He mostly played the blues. And he was really, really good. He was like a really, really good guitarist. Very, very impressive, very, very fast, loads of skill. And I still remember to this day my very first lesson with him. And he asked me, well, why do you want to play guitar? And I said, well, because I think it's awesome. I want to play like Eric Clapton and stuff, you know, like I want to play cool music. And he was like, oh, well, let me show you like some of the stuff that you can learn playing guitar. And he basically just played for me for about 20 minutes, just playing blues, playing like solos and stuff. And man, he sold me, man. That day I was like, dude, you had me at hello, man. That is awesome. I want to play the guitar so bad right now. And anyway, I started playing the guitar, started having lessons every day at my school, and I got pretty good pretty quickly, considering I'd been playing piano for a lot of my life. I've been playing other instruments. I sort of had it down, you know, like how to play an instrument. And so it didn't take me very long to learn how to play guitar and to get pretty good at guitar, actually. And one of my best friends at school also started learning the guitar at the same time. And we started jamming together, started practicing together. And before we knew it, we were talking about starting a band. We were like, dude, let's make a freaking band right now, man. Both of us, we both had the same motivation, man. The same motivation was to impress girls. It always is. That is what guys do on this planet, man. We just do everything we can to impress girls. And we were like, let's start a band. And because we had a sister school, right? The school that I went to was an all-boys school of about 500 boys. But we had a sister school just down the road. And sometimes we used to do plays and stuff with them. So we would see the girls and stuff. And we thought, you know what? If we have a band, maybe we could go and play at that school, at the girls' school. And maybe we could get a girlfriend. Or maybe if we're really lucky, we could get a kiss, man. And that would just be like the best thing ever. So we started jamming together and we started forming a band. And let's just have a look at what I've done over here, guys, before we carry on. What the jazz is going on up there? Looks like I've messed up the roof a bit over there. And there was another guy at my school who was learning to play the drums. But he was learning to play like classical drums, because we had like a small orchestra at my school. I mean, it was a pretty bad orchestra, obviously, because all the kids, you know. oh, that was not good. Because everyone in the orchestra was like a kid, right? So, I don't know. The orchestra was pretty bad. looks like I need to take away one line up there. Okay. So we went to the drummer and we were like, dude, listen here, man. We have a sweet plan. We're going to start a band and then we're going to go play at the girls' school and we're going to get girlfriends and it is going to be sweet. Do you want to be in our band? And this guy was like, hell yeah, I'm going to be in your band. I'm going to be the drummer. So we picked up the drummer. We got a drummer in the band. And then there was a guy who was playing bass guitar for the orchestra of my school. And we were like, dude, do you want to be the bass guitarist of our band? And the guy was like, hell yeah, I'm going to be a bass guitarist of your band. And so we started what was actually the very first band at my school. Like no one had ever started a band other than like a freaking recorder band or whatever, you know, like a really lame ass band that the music teacher had put together. No one had ever actually made like a proper band at that school. So I'm kind of proud of that, man. We were like the pioneers of the band at that school. And I think that ever since then, I think it's called the contemporary band is now a thing. So you have like the orchestra and you have the contemporary band. And I'm proud to say that I was a part of that, man. I was a part of the formation of the contemporary freaking band. And I still remember our very first practice. My guitar teacher was there with us. He was trying to teach us like some of the stuff that we had to play. And I still remember the repertoire of that band like completely, man. We didn't have like loads of songs. We only had a few songs and they were all awesome though. Let me see if I can remember them. Okay, so the first song that we ever learned, and whenever I pick up my guitar, like sometimes I just play this riff just because it's like the first riff that I ever played, or ever played in the band anyway. The first song that I ever learned in this very first band. And by the way, before I get into that, the name of the band, I know you guys are all dying to know. We named the band Diamond Illusion. Have no idea what it means, and it's freaking lame as lame gets. But we thought it was epic, man. We thought it was the most epic band name ever. Anyway, so Diamond Illusion had like a pretty limited repertoire. Man, that is looking awesome, people. That looks so awesome. The first song that we ever learned and the first song that we ever practiced was by a band called Deep Purple. And for you older cyber dogs out there, you know what song, right? You know what song. Down, 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 down. Smoke on the water, fire in the sky, down, down, down. Oh man, that was an epic tune. We learned that song. The next song that we learned was another rock classic, Stairway to Heaven by Led Zeppelin. There's a lady who's sure all that glitters is gold, and she's buying a stairway to heaven. Man, that was an awesome song. Then we, like, that was the first two songs that our guitar teacher taught us. Oh, no. Okay, that was bad. Dang it. Oh, man. What a freaking noob. Oh, my bad. Oh, man. Lost 23 freaking levels. Oh, man. See, this is what happens, man. This is what happens when I tell you guys stories. I lose concentration. Anyway, so guys, we learned Led Zeppelin, we learned Deep Purple, and then I was like, dude, we want to learn more modern songs, man. Girls aren't going to know these songs. Like, we want to learn way more modern songs. So he was like, okay, you guys can choose. So, the first modern song that we learned, or that we chose, was by my favorite band when I was that age, when I was like 10, and it was by a band called The Offspring, and this song was called Self Esteem. And man, for those of you guys who know the song, it is an epic track, man. How does it go again? The chorus is just away, yeah, away, yeah. But I'm not going to sing it because it's too high. And the fourth and final song that we had in our repertoire of modern songs was by a band called Green Day. And loads of you guys know Green Day now, but this was from their like second record, man. And this was a song called Basket Case. And this song goes, do you have the time to listen to me whine about nothing and everything all at once? I am one of those melodramatic fools, neurotic to the bone, no doubt about it. Oh man, it was awesome. And that was our repertoire, man. That was it. We didn't write any of our own songs, but we practiced those songs as hard as we freaking could. And we got pretty good at those songs, actually. And at one point, we even performed for the school. And our like pride and joy, man, our most epic and most awesome moment was when we got asked to play at one of the social events where there were girls, and we set up our little stage in the TV room of this kid's house that the social was at, and we set up the drums and the guitars and everything, and we played that night, and it was freaking awesome, man. Everybody was there, like everybody got to the social and they saw the drums and the guitars. Everybody was so freaking excited. All the girls were like, oh my god, this is awesome, there's a band. And they didn't know that it was us, and we played our four songs. I remember like the mum came to me and she was like, it's time to play, the time has come, it is band time. Like we played enough Spin the Bottle, everybody's had at least 2 liters of Coke, everybody is ready for you, man. Get on that stage and play. And I remember the mum turned the lights off in the lounge that we were playing in. The lights went down. We turned on our amplifiers. There was feedback. The drums were rattling. Everything was going a bit crazy. And then we kicked into Basket Case, man. We kicked into Green Day. And then everybody in the crowd, all the girls, all the guys, everybody was jumping up and down. Everybody was singing the lyrics because everybody knew that song. That was like the biggest song at my school at that time, man. And it was just amazing. We played that song and then we played Offspring and everybody was jumping around. And then we played Deep Purple and Led Zeppelin and everyone was like, meh. Everybody left to go play more Spin the Bottle because they didn't know those songs. I like to think that they didn't appreciate them, man. But that was Diamond Illusion's first gig, and it was freaking epic. We tore the freaking roof down, man. The roof was on fire that night. Damn! And no, I didn't get a kiss or get a girlfriend from it, but that was just the very first step in my dream. And it was that night where suddenly I realized, you know what? I want to be in a band, man. Like, this is so freaking awesome. Like, I want to do this again, but I want to do this on a bigger scale. And it became my goal to try and be in a band and try to like get big, right? And try and get famous. And this was in my junior school, right? In my like smaller school, or whatever you want to call it. And we played all year round. We played gigs every week. We played at like, we got really, really good. We went on tours, like we played at different schools. It was awesome. We did really well. But then my time at my junior school came to an end and I had to go to high school. And luckily, the guitarist who was in my band in junior school was going to the same high school. And that was when the dream really started to come alive, man. That is when things started to get freaking serious, man. Damn! And it was awesome. But I tell you what, guys, we run out of time in this episode. But in the next episode, we're going to continue my story. Continue on this story. And I'm going to be telling you guys exactly how Mama Dog got involved in this dream. And how she did everything that she could to help us realize our freaking dream when we were in high school. And it was awesome, man. So guys, in the next episode, we're going to be continuing with this story. But in the background, I think I really freaking like that new design over there. Absolutely love the wall design that the Cyber Dog gave me on dogcraft.net. I think it's beautiful. It's perfect for this monument. And if you can imagine, we're going to have four of those, right? We're going to have four of those buildings in the Cyber Dog monument. And then the diagonal ones will just be balconies. And that's going to help like break up the symmetry of the monument, and as well as like maintain symmetry at the same time. And it's going to be freaking sweet, guys. I'll tell you what, man. I'm going to end the episode here. Really hope you guys have enjoyed it. Stay tuned in the next episode. We're going to continue my story about how I almost got famous. Well, that's a slight exaggeration. But I like to think in my mind that I almost got famous. Guys, this has been Rentog playing Minecraft Survival. We will see you in the next episode where we continue working on the Cyberdog Monument and talking about my freaking band. Thank you so much for watching, guys. If you enjoyed it, you hit that like button. If you haven't subscribed yet, you hit that subscribe button. I'll see you in the next video, my friends. I have no idea what accent that was. Goodbye, my friends.